and this is the only walking I'm going to do during this conference. So let me start. Let's start with Greg, but we're going to ask you all three to start the same question. What does technology-enabled disruption mean in your industry? What are the implications for you?
So, and I'm going to use some slides. One of the things, we're in the crude oil pipeline business, so you might ask the question, what kind of technology actually can be impacted or, you know, in some of the ways that Rob talked about? Just a quick slide here that shows
let's start with Greg.
We certainly have been impacted by technology and disruption, and I've used these slides to kind of give you some visuals because otherwise it'd take me 2 hours. I'd probably confuse everybody, including myself. So there's two elements. One is horizontal drilling, and the other is hydraulic fracturing. So if you look in the upper right, horizontal drilling, quite simply, is simply the ability to turn the corner. And we drill 7,000 feet into the surface, and then we turn it literally horizontal. And so if you can imagine taking big, thick steel pipe and being able to put an elbow in it and continue to extend. And that's really a relatively recent technology within the last 10 years that's been perfected. By itself, that doesn't do the disruption that we're going to talk about. If you then combine it with hydraulic fracturing, which is in the lower half of this slide, it's the ability to work within that extended lateral. And you think about 9,000 feet, that's right at about 2 miles of distance horizontally underneath the surface within a particular zone. And so we have the ability to shoot holes in the pipe, pump high volume water and high volume sand in to create fractures to enable the oil and gas then to flow back into the wellbore. So you say, okay, you're exploring for oil and gas and you're bringing it in. How does that disrupt it? Well, those two have been so dramatic, and it has a huge impact, has had a huge impact on the U.S. economy and also national security. So in the upper left, you'll see the demand over the last roughly 40 plus years has been stable to increasing. Yet in the lower left, the lower onshore production has been declining steadily for decades. And about where that dotted line is about the introduction of the combination of horizontal drilling and hydraulic fracturing. And we've gone from 3 million barrels a day up to about 10 million barrels a day in that relatively short time period. You talk about disruption, and the impact on the economy is kind of shown in the lower right. We've been reliant on net export imports, and effectively we've reduced that net imports from about 12.5 million barrels a day to about right around a million to a million and a half barrels a day, so about a 90% decrease. And if you do the math on that, that's $250 billion a year to the U.S. trade balance to the positive, okay, that's had during that time period. So then it gets back to our business. And so what's happened is we had slack in our pipelines. It rapidly filled that up. We had too much of the wrong kind of crude in the U.S., so we needed to remove the restriction on exports to foreign countries. It triggered a reversal and a conversion of many pipelines in our business to redirect the crude oil to the right location, primarily to the coast. It also attracted significant investment in new entrants and capital at a time when capital was relatively cheap. And it moved the U.S. from the number three producer in the world to the number one. So in the lower left, you can see exports that have happened again from almost non-existent until recently. And then you can see the U.S. going from the third largest, shown in red, to the largest by a wide margin. And then I'll just close with just one comment, which is it's also created a lot of challenges, a lot of new sector entrants. Rob's talked about margin compression. We've seen some of our margins on our historic pipelines go down by 50%, while at the same time we're investing new capital, which make it a positive return. In some cases, it's netted down to where the gains haven't been nearly as significant as you would think. Skilled labor, in this case, we've actually created more labor demand because this process is very labor intensive. And so we tell people in Midland, Texas, if you're unemployed, it's only because you quit your one job and you haven't started the other one across the street yet. So in any event, it's created a tremendous amount of challenges. It's very positive for the economy and for national security on particular companies. It can be challenging to existing business, great for new business. So those are hopefully a framework.
So two things I might ask you to comment on. One, explain a little bit more why you're seeing margin compression. And then just for the audience here, the output per worker, in other words, the impact it's had on your business in terms of output per worker, number of workers that work in certainly you're not directly on the well, but we know workers per well has decreased. How does it affect the productivity of your workforce?
So on the margin compression at first, we had historic pipelines and we had less competition, and because nobody wanted to be in a business that was declining, you know, very rapidly, and all of a sudden we went to it's inclining, we filled up capacity, and we had good margins, and they got better when you add higher utilization on existing assets. What happened also, Rob, is we ended up with a low cost of capital in low interest rate environment, and so it was easier for people to come in, and we would might have a $3 tariff on an existing pipeline, and somebody would build a brand new pipeline beside us to take the new barrels, and they might be able to do a 20% rate of return at a $1.50 a barrel. So we actually had to sit there and look at it and say, we're going to have to lower our tariffs on our existing. The new investments that were being made are actually generating very positive returns, but it basically added a lot of compression there. And then, candidly, we end up with so many new entrants that we're not even sure some of them could spell oil, but they know where to get the money. And so they come in, and we're now in a situation where fits and starts of overcapacity. And then the labor side of it, we're more productive per worker, unbelievably. It's just we've required many more workers because we have, again, if you go from 3 million barrels to 10 million barrels, it takes more people to make that happen. When you haul sand and water and the logistics to get to be able to do those new technologies, it's you know, blocking and tackling, but it takes a lot of blockers and tacklers. And so it's really put compression there, but we're much more efficient. Used to, we might have, you know, 6 or 7 rig hands on the rig. We're doing it now with 3, but we've taken those 3 and put them in, you know, driving trucks and need to be trained to be able to get the product to the field.
And who trains them? Someone else, or do you train them?
Everybody. We've actually started working with the colleges and trying to train the workers and help them shape their programs, because it's really a shortage. I mean, the unemployment is below 3% in Midland. I think Midland, Texas is the highest wages in the state of Texas, in fact, is maybe in most metropolitan areas just because of that. I mean, if you want to be a truck driver, you could make $100,000, $110,000 a year driving a truck. It's not simply going from point A to point B. There's a lot of things you have to do besides hold the steering wheel. But we've had to train those. And then, of course, the new entrants then hire our people, and we have to train, you know, more people. And so it's been pretty vicious out there.
Okay, good. Thank you. Craig, how's technology-enabled disruption affecting your industry and your business?
Well, certainly serving the frackers in Midland has been fantastic for our business, our best barbecue restaurant in the state. We're happy to be serving your folks. Obviously, grocery business has been around for a long time and not often thought to be a very technologically advanced business, but in the last decade or two, we've been kind of on a rocket ship to be a lot more technologically advanced as an industry. Certainly Amazon Whole Foods put a big injection of power and capital into the space, and we're seeing lots of innovation across a million aspects of the value chain to deliver groceries to U.S. homes. I'd focus it on 4 or 5 different things that are happening in the grocery business. The first is enabled a bunch of new sales channels. So at HEB, obviously we have about 400 stores, but it's enabled us to deliver and have many different sales channels to deliver groceries to folks. So we have a big curbside business where you order online and you pick up in store. We have that in a couple hundred stores. We have several different home delivery businesses. We have a W-2 business where we have partners delivering groceries to your home. We have a 1099 gig economy business where we have the largest independent fleet, a gig economy delivery service in the state, delivering groceries to customers' homes. We acquired a company called Favor that delivers some groceries, but also lots of restaurant meals to homes. And we have a ship-to-home from warehouse to mostly expats who are desperate for tortillas in Boston or wherever they're living. So there are a bunch of different businesses that have spawned, but I think of those really as just different sales channels to deliver similar products than what we've been serving for a long time. We also have a bunch of new businesses that are evolving in the retail space, broadly speaking, especially kind of long-tail businesses. Chewy.com is making a massive inroads into the pet business and enabling, taking over kind of the pet specialty business, enabling much better long-tail distribution to customers, making it really disrupting the pet business in a dramatic way and serving a wide variety and much better serving of the customer and unique one-to-one tailoring to love your pet. Stitch Fix is doing kind of the same thing in the apparel business and kind of taking the burden for people like me who don't like to shop for clothes, taking the burden off, making the decision much easier, enabling kind of stylist and fulfillment. So dramatically different businesses. Certainly there's a bunch of new businesses around delivery, Favor, DoorDash, Uber Eats, and many different kind of delivery businesses are emerging. The third thing we also see is vastly new marketing channels. So of course we have lots of TV and print ads still, but we know what's happening there. So vast shifting of financial resources into digital marketing. As we all know, Google is really a targeted marketing company. And we know that many of these businesses are kind of living off of a fundamental shift in marketing expense and the way companies are going to reach customers in a better one-to-one basis. So you're saving massive amounts of shifting in digital marketing resources. We also see a bunch of, the fourth thing I'd say is we see a lot of business process improvement with big data, AI, machine learning. We have vast amounts of data on everything you eat and where you shop and how you shop and how different customers shop differently, individually, person by person, neighborhood by neighborhood. We've always tried to do that with our stores. We try to tailor our stores neighborhood by neighborhood. Now we can do it by person and have very different ability to target market, suggestive selling, predictive selling of what you will want. That's not only important on the customer side, but in a business that has unbelievable perishability. You walk into our Central Market or our H-E-B store, you usually walk into a big produce department. Our stuff is gone in 2 days. And we're buying different products from 50 countries around the world. Every Christmas has its own holiday on a different day. Every pattern's different. The weather changes, the holidays changes, food stamps change. Very perishable product. So massive supply chain where we're bringing bananas from Costa Rica and managing that whole process. We have the largest ripening room for bananas, avocados, mangoes in the country. But that process of landing product exactly when it's the right ripeness and having a store with a bunch of yellow, a bunch of semi-green, quite green, a bunch of avocados that are hard for later, ready for today, and everything in between. It's a massive logistics supply chain business. So you're seeing unbelievable innovation through the supply chain of better supply chain management, better predictive selling, better understanding of what weather patterns, store by store differences, customer by customer differences will do to improve how we manage inventory in the supply chain. Lots of other things I could talk about there. And then also in manufacturing, we are also a self-manufacturer. We produce lots of the own products that we sell. We just recently launched a plant in Houston selling salty snacks. We're the only large retailer in the country, I believe, that has over 50% share in salty snacks in our market. And we have lots of sensors to improve how we better manage the process of manufacturing chips or food each way along the way, and having much better understanding of the small varieties of how much seasoning is on a chip, what's the quality of the product, much better inventory management throughout the manufacturing process. And then the last thing I'd say is just testing innovation. Obviously, the thing that matters a lot is the pace of change has changed dramatically. I don't think there's a lot about tech that's different than all the rest of the world of innovation through history, other than the pace of change is really different. There are a few other things I'll talk about later. But we're testing robotic picking. Obviously, e-commerce is a vastly less profitable exercise than selling through the grocery store. And selling through the grocery store is not that profitable of a business either. So it takes a very low margin business and makes it a lot worse. And so people are testing lots of ways to improve the economics. We do most of the picking in store. We've doubled the productivity of our pickers in store, but we're also testing the equivalent of mini mill robotics pickers in neighborhoods. There are many different debates, like the steel mills. You have big robotic warehouse that serves all of Dallas-Fort Worth, or you have a mini mill that serves each neighborhood, and there are lots of different companies and lots of different versions, but we're testing that. We're also testing the use of autonomous vehicles for delivery. I believe, and we'll see, I believe that the primary place that that's going to start is in last mile delivery. The last mile is always the most challenging, And I'm not sure I'm ready to put, our trucks average about 80,000 pounds. I'm not sure I'm ready to put an 80,000 pound missile on the highways in Texas on I-35 without a driver there. We're very proud of our drivers. Safety is super important. And so I think where you're going to see autonomous vehicles start is in the last mile, slow stuff, delivering to your home. And so those are some of the things that are happening in the grocery space.
We're going to come back through and go through some of these in more detail. But when I ask you about one, and you started with this, about the home delivery, and then you mentioned at the end e-commerce, I gather that a substantial percentage of home delivery never doesn't involve the store. It involves a warehouse with pickers and likely happens online. You might explain how that works.
There are many different models of how this works, and many companies do it differently. Tesco is the largest retailer in the UK. They were really the first big grocer to be in the home delivery business. They went straight from stores to home delivery. They put big warehouses in place to pick at a warehouse because you get a better pick efficiency in a store, in a warehouse. So just using rough numbers, in a store, you can pick 50 or 60 items per hour because there's a complexity using the store. In the warehouse, we can pick, you know, 300 to 500 units per hour, depending on what kind of robotics and automation you use. So that is obviously in a low-margin business. You'd want to pick in a big warehouse with a lot of efficiency, but then you've got the last-mile costs and the delivery costs. So it's a balancing act. Do you want one big warehouse with a lot of capital from one central place delivering all across the beautiful traffic of Austin, Houston, Dallas? Or do you want a bunch of little ones picking in mini mills? Or do you want them picking in store? We have stores within 3 miles of most Texas.
So I'm curious, what percentage of your volume now is comprised of this new type of shopping?
So as a private company, we joyously don't have to report those numbers. And we are very happy that.
And talking then industry-wide, whatever you're comfortable.
So in industry, the grocery space, while we feel this pressure of Amazon, this unbelievable level of tech disruption, especially in retail and electronics and toys and apparel, the grocery space, because of the perishability and the cold supply chain, is only 3% penetration sold online and either fulfilled through curbside, ship to home, or home delivery. Huh. Now that's, you know, growing quite a bit. In the UK, it's 7%, but it's closer to 10% in London. New York has Fresh Direct and roughly 7%. South Korea is about 16% of the grocery space. So, I think many different people have a different view of where it's going to go. But we strongly believe, and we think Whole Foods, Amazon confirms this, we strongly believe the grocery space is not going to be either stores or online. It's going to be both.
Could be a mix.
And the question for all of us is, how do we become great omni-channel retailers and have fantastic user experience like you get here in Central Market stores and make people want to love the store? And then how do you make it a heck of a lot easier because stores are crowded, moms are busy, and how do we provide quick, easy ordering, don't wait in line for deli, drive by the store and pick it up, have it delivered to home, be a great tech company? And we think the answer is going to be both.
And the last thing, you mentioned the pace of change is accelerating, and this is part of what we're talking about. Why do you think it's accelerating so much?
Well, I'd like to go back and talk about that a little bit later, but I do think there are some tech, obviously the phone hasn't been around. I mean, Google was, hasn't been around for more than 20 years, and we didn't have all the things we've got in the phone. So the phone, the ability to manage big pools of data instead of in data sets, to use unstructured data. So I'm not the tech guy, so there's a lot of tech reasons. But I also do think the capital markets have a reason here, and there's a double-edged sword, and maybe we can hold the phone on that and talk about that a bit.
And just
later.
For those, what are you referring? And we've talked a lot about this, which is an interesting topic for central bankers to grapple with. The low cost of capital has allowed many of these new entrants to thrive, often with very little prospect of future profitability, but big market valuations, and you get to compete with them.
Exactly. It's so
and so
wonderful.
We'll talk more about that. But low cost of capital has probably been a significant factor in this acceleration, we believe. Yeah. Brant, how about you? How's it affecting BNSF?
Thanks for having me. And it might surprise the audience the grocery business and the freight railroading business actually have a lot in common. There's a lot of what Craig said that may be redundant or repetitive because we share a lot of the same perspectives. But just for some orientation for the audience, BNSF Railways, leading national freight railway. We operate in the western half of the United States. We cover 28 states, two Canadian provinces. And we're really in the business of moving what the economy produces or consumes. We have four primary business units. We have our agricultural business units that moves grain and grain products from the field to export to domestic markets. We have our energy business unit, which is predominantly around coal, that we move out of the Powder River Basin to the coal-fired power plants to generate electricity. We have our industrial products business unit, which really follows the manufacturing and construction products side of the economy, aggregates, pipe, you know, the more traditional carload types of businesses. And then we have our consumer products business unit, which is follows the consuming economy. It's intermodal and automotive. So intermodal is the trailers and containers that we load to and from our rail network, either domestic shipments or international imports as well. And then we also have the finished vehicle side of things within the consumer products side of the business. And just one last piece of orientation in terms of where I sit in the organization with business unit operations is I actually sit uniquely in the organization where I report to our chief operating officer and our chief commercial officer, and that's because what I'm responsible for is operationally oriented, but it's customer facing. So rail car fleet sizing and distribution is part of my responsibilities. Our national call center, as Rob said, as well as our intermodal and automotive terminal operations where those terminals actually load the trailers and containers or the finished vehicles to and from our rail network. And why that's important to outline for the audience is because I sit there in that organization, operations and marketing, we've long been what we think is an innovative company. We're a 170-year-old company, industrial company. And so we think that we've long been in the innovation space, and that's, you know, if we were still moving freight today the way that we were doing hundreds of years ago, we wouldn't be as relevant as we are today. But so since I sit between those two organizations, they've asked me to help lead our innovation efforts. So that's really, you know, we've been doing it for a long time, but a central point of coordination to help the business leaders identify problems that need to be solved, and then liaison to the technology side of the world to find emerging technologies that can solve those priority business problems. And so as I play in that space of technology, what we would do probably is replace the word disruption with transformation. It sounds a little cliche, but it's often said that if technology is happening to you, it's disruptive. But if you're investing in it, if you're enabling it, if you're developing it and you're adopting it and deploying it, it's transformative. And that's where really we are inclined to lean from the technology perspective. And we see it influencing all aspects of our business. We see it impacting safety of our employees. We see it.
And so you might go through two or three ways specifically, just so the audience can get a sense, absolutely, visualize, how's the technology-enabled disruption affecting your business?
Right. So on the safety.
Or transformation.
Yeah, on the safety side of things, you know, artificial intelligence, machine learning, image analytics help us actually be able to see things and predict exceptions or failures before they happen. So we prevent the failure from happening online. From a service execution standpoint or service delivery side to our ultimate customer, we see technology enabling greater visibility in the supply chain. We see technology streamlining the interface points as we integrate with our customers. And what that means is in the supply chain, every time there's a handoff, that's a friction point. And friction is inefficient. And that's whether it's a physical interchange, handing a container or trailer off from our intermodal facility to the motor carrier who delivers it in the final mile, that's a friction point. Or if it's an information exchange, when is my shipment going to be where it's supposed to be? That information exchange can be a point of inefficiency. So we see technology able to streamline that. On the cost control side of things, we see a lot of opportunity in the artificial intelligence side, which I've already mentioned. We see the potential for automation of certain manual tasks that may be semi-automation, full automation, which helps our employees do their jobs more efficiently, which helps us control costs.
So you and I talked at length in our previous conversations about some concrete, and what we want to do here is give people just a sense as they go back and do more research, and we don't have, none of us here have a technology, very few of us have a technology background. You were giving an example of some of those handoffs for me and how it's changing the nature of your workforce, and why don't you give a couple of examples?
You bet. So in the space that I'm responsible for in terms of intermodal terminal operations, the way that works is a motor carrier, a truck driver, will bring a shipment in our gate, and that brings it into inventory. And we tell them to go park that unit in a parking stall to stage it for outbound loading. And so they park it in that stall, they disconnect. And then one of our employees with a yard truck, so it looks like a street truck, but it just operates in the yard, then will connect to that trailer that's in a parking stall and take it to the production space, which is rail side next to a rail car, where a crane will then lift that onto the rail car. And that horizontal movement is done today with an equipment operator operating that truck. And we see opportunities to semi-automate that, remotely operate that, or fully automate that. And by the way, that's not new.
Does that mean no operator? He's sitting in a desk rather than on a truck? Is that what that means?
Ultimately, that's what it can mean. And the marine container handling terminals around the world are doing that today. As a matter of fact, and I think this is germane to the conversation, automation of container handling terminals dates back to the early 90s. But there are only a handful of terminals that are fully automated. But that capability, yes, is available to us. So we're not inventing anything, but we are modifying it for our application and deploying that. So yes, ultimately, the ultimate vision is in some configurations, that piece of intermodal equipment that moves trailers and containers from a staging area to production area could be fully automated and
which
not have an operator in there.
So no operator, autonomous, but operated remotely from a control center?
Correct. So you can remove the operator from the external environment and put them in more of a traditional environment where they can oversee that automation from a desk.
Is someone outside your business disrupting you?
It would be arrogant for us to say that, you know, we're immune to disruption. But we think that, what we do in the supply chain provides a lot of value. We think that it would be difficult to replicate the size and scale of what we do and the value that we provide, but we are watching it closely.
So what's the threat you're watching? What are the threats you're watching?
So it really is around, new technologies, emerging technologies that are being deployed potentially ahead of us. We were watching a lot of the final mile delivery stuff and the technologies that can couple into our space. But the way that we really address that is we plug into the various ecosystems, I guess is sometimes an overused word, but we plug into the Silicon Valley world where there are startup accelerators and emerging technologies to watch what's going on in that space and see what could potentially disrupt us or what could potentially complement us. We watch what's going on in industrial operations around the world like this. And so we're plugged into those ecosystem systems to help us rest assured that we won't be disrupted per se.
And last two more questions. How are you impacting the trucking business? By the way, BNSF was my client for more than 20, 25 years. And so I know a lot of the discussion has been you versus trucks, you versus other modes. What's the impact you're having on trucking, if any?
So I would say that is a common perspective that it's us versus the trucks or where.
Or is there any, but what's the impact?
But they're actually among our largest customers.
Yeah.
So among our largest customers are the UPSs of the world, FedExes of the world, J.B. Hunts of the world, Schneiders. I can list all those. They are some of our largest, most trusted partners. And that's because that intermodal supply chain allows those companies to focus on what they do really well, which is that final mile delivery, and allow us to do the long haul, Los Angeles to Chicago, right at scale. So an average intermodal train can move 250 containers on a single train, and we can do that much more efficiently than drivers. And if you read the headlines, you can see that the nation is really facing a pretty substantial driver shortage in terms of the number of drivers available to drive those trucks. And so we think we complement the trucking industry.
Okay, so the last question I was going to ask, if you look out 10, 15 years from now, without regard to increases in volume, do you expect your workforce to increase or be the same? And what will the mix be? And what will be the, you'll have less of certain kinds of jobs, and what are the new skills you're going to have to train more of as a result of this?
Yeah, so there's a lot in that question. It's always a little bit dangerous to predict the future. But I think history can always be our guide. And so if you look at the national freight rail industry in the early 1970s, there were, I think, roughly 500,000 employees across the North American freight rail industry. And if you look today, I haven't looked recently, but it's less than 200,000. Right? So there are fewer rail employees. But I think it's important to understand that there's no piece of technology that you take off a shelf and you displace an employee, right? So that just doesn't happen. If you go back to the example of marine terminal automation, it started in the early 90s, and we're still not fully automated across those operations. So I think the pace of that follows a natural attrition. And so I think there will be fewer employees. I think the nature of the employees continues to follow the technology, which means over time, you know, the new employees coming into our organization, no matter what the job is, are going to be people who are more comfortable in the digital space. And we see that happening naturally, and we can help that with some of our training as well. And then, again, I think that you take employees from what may be a more manual task, lower on the spectrum of cognitive challenge, and you move them into a more cognitively challenging space. And so with some of the image analytics, wayside detection that can perceive problems with rolling stock, we take those employees from being finders, you know, trying to find the problem, into and turn those into fixers who can fix or prevent a problem. And that's what big data analytics, artificial intelligence allows us to do this. So that's the kind of trend line that I see within the workforce.
All right, so let's stop here. I can ask more questions. Let's throw it open at this point, and I'll come back later. And I guess, do you want folks to go to the microphone? Is that? All right, so sorry about that. If you have your hand up, sorry about this. You're going to have to walk. We're trying to get you some exercise.
This is a somewhat provocative question, but so we start by saying the pace of change, Industrial Revolution 3, is faster. How do we measure that? Because if I go back and think about electricity and plumbing, indoor plumbing, and automobiles, that was pretty rapid pace of change. So how are we measuring this? Is it based on standard of living? Because that seems like it was a lot more impactful to us than what we're seeing now. Or is it based on perception because we're in the moment? How are we measuring this pace of change?
Please.
I don't have the numbers at my fingertips, but if you look at the penetration of different technologies over time and how quickly they reached a million people or a certain percentage of the population, how quickly TV or radio got to X percent of the population, the phone and digital media has gotten there in fractions of the time it took years ago. So that's one easy way to measure it.
How about Greg or Brant?
You know, it is a provocative question. I would tell you that there's a couple of things that are working at cross purposes in trying to measure the perception of change. I think, at least in our business, and there's, you know, I talked about things that affect the volumes that we move. There's a tremendous amount of technology. It's kind of like Craig's talking about behind the scenes that's going on. And to some extent, where, you know, when you can combine automation, but you have to have artificial intelligence to be able to, I think replacing the employees is not as important as sometimes replacing the employee's ability to make a mistake. And therefore, you get greater efficiency. And so your investment is more not just cost on that, but the efficiency overall. I think the issue is, for example, in our business, the pipeline business is much, much more efficient and less disruptions in terms of service and in terms of environmental exposure than what we had 20 or 30 years ago. The number, if you looked at the efficiency of the barrels that we move and the numbers that ever get out of the pipe, which is called a release or a spill, and it gets in the headlines, is so many digits, okay, that I would be an hour up here telling you how many 0001, you know, volumes actually get out of the pipe. The problem is the minute they get out of the pipe, the press puts it in the, because we've got 24/7. So the perception is, gosh, we're having more incidences, and the answer is actually less incidents, just more media publications. And so it's a good question. I think there's a perception and a reality. Reality is it's been pretty rapid. It's been pretty effective and efficient. The bad news is everything gets publicized, and so everybody thinks that there's a disaster happening in a minute. The answer is there used to be disasters happening every 60, you know, every 10 seconds, and now it's much, much sparser than that.
What about the standard of living question? Should we be measuring how many
I think that's a major concern for what we're facing, given the vast amount of invested capital that's gone into technology, how little impact it has on the productivity of the U.S. workforce, and how little it has done to rise up and create employment across this country. That is super concerning to us.
And why do you think, so we've spent a lot of time at the Fed talking about why this is. Some of it we think may be education hasn't caught up to it. Why do you think productivity has not improved more, even though by business appears to be improving a lot?
You know, one thing that really is concerning to me, and, you know, I'm going to skip ahead to something I think we were going to cover. I think there are two main concerns here with the tech disruption. One is I do believe the pace of change has gotten dramatically faster, and we all have to move much faster than we've ever imagined before. This is a normal innovation cycle. There are many great things about this innovation cycle. We can talk about all the good things that are happening, that are making life easier for millions of people, being able to feed billions of people in a better way. There's lots of great things that are happening. And sometimes we get kind of lost in the political dynamic and the woe is me. But we are doing a much better job, you know, educating, taking care of healthcare, having a better standard of living, having life expectancy, like all the measures that economists out there should, like the world is a much better place, right? But it's hard to keep up with the pace of change, and companies, economists have a hard time moving as fast as this world is changing. So that's something we all have to adopt to. But that's normal. The thing that I really worry about in the retail space is the capital markets have given vast sums of money to invest in technological businesses that make dramatic losses. And in the retail space, just focusing on retail, this year alone, 6,000 stores have closed, which is more than all of last year. In the electronics space, 5,000 electronic stores have been eliminated from the face of this earth over the last decade. Almost the entirety of the electronics retail, toy retail, bookstores, baby stores have basically been wiped out by companies that make no money in the fulfillment of those services. And the capital markets have given unbelievable quantities of capital to sustain unprofitable businesses to wipe out traditional economies and jobs. So I think we as economists, regulators, antitrust, need a modern 21st century version of how do we handle that problem, because don't we all worry about what jobs our kids are going to have and our grandkids? That's unbelievably important for me, and how do we handle that? And I do think, Rob, it comes back to, I do believe monetary policy was a great savior to this country in 2008 and getting ourselves out of the financial ditch. I think the way the Fed has handled that has been fantastic, but there are unintended negative consequences to continued low rates and lots of stimulus that have led the capital markets to do bad things to this country. It's happening again. We already have huge levels of corporate debt. We have companies going, you know, unicorns going public that will probably never make money, wiping out jobs for your grandkids. That is a major problem.
Brant, you want to comment?
Yeah, I might add on the productivity side of things that from my perspective where I sit is there's the pace of technology development and the pace of adoption. And those two things don't match. And so what I've seen our company do over the last several years is try to accelerate the pace of adoption. So historically, a company like mine might see a piece of technology. We would analyze it for a very, very long time to see if it has the ROI that we look for. And then we would do a pilot project that would last for an extended period of time. And then if that were to prove itself out on the pilot, then we would do a multi-year, multi-site rollout. And you're starting to see us now be more agile in that and less precise. And so we might see now, and I'll give you a concrete example, a piece of technology emerge where it makes sense on the surface. We would analyze it, but not analyze it to death. We would pilot it. Some say fail fast. We don't like the word fail because when things fail in the rail industry, that can be not good. So we try to say learn fast, reiterate it, and then prove it. And then if it proves out, then scale quickly. An example of that would be we've just implemented some new inventory control measures at our intermodal terminals where we have to load the trains effectively. We have to know where the trailers and containers are at in our terminals. And today, that's done manually because of the size and scale and complexity of what we do. It only takes one truck driver to park in the wrong spot for the inventory to be misplaced, right? And so we pay people to literally drive around our facilities and inventory reconcile. So the inventory can be hours old. It still works today, but we have deployed some fixed-base cameras that oversee our terminal operations that will follow that inventory to the precise location that's at. So it's real-time, it's accurate, and it's automated. We developed the concept, we analyzed it, we said that we think this has benefits. We piloted it for a few months, and then we deployed it at a site, proved it out, and now we're going to do 10 sites instead of one at a time over a period of time.
So you experiment more and faster.
And so the pace of adoption can start to match the pace of development, and therefore you maybe get the productivity faster.
Yes, sir.
How are you doing this morning? David Waltz with SWBC in San Antonio. I think one of the challenges we see at all today is, as a financial services company, is truly, you know, attracting top technical talent. Whereas we're dabbling in artificial machine intelligence, machine learning, and robotic process automation, when you're competing against the Amazons and the Googles of the world, sometimes that's a real challenge for us. I'm just kind of curious, from your perspectives in different industries, how do you guys deal with that?
Anybody who wants to take
it? I'd say talent recruitment's always been a challenge. I mean, believe it or not, in the last 4 or 5 years, we've lost a lot of our technical talent in the IT areas to the Amazons of the world. I mean, even out of the energy business. I mean, they're just trying to attract really bright people and saying, we can teach you whatever you need to do, or you can learn on the job. So I'd say it's a challenge, and I think part of it is there's this aura of mystique of wanting to be involved in that. And, you know, we're in kind of the, you know, dumb iron business effectively. And so, you know, we do some to that mental challenge. And certainly there's some financial incentives there, but we try to fight that. I mean, we've tried to wallet whip people to come back, and it's a challenge. So I it's just constant. I don't know how to interrupt that.
Yeah, I think that the future digital and algorithmic businesses are going to win. I think Netflix is going to win over the cable companies. The Venmos are going to be, you know, powerful in the banking business, the Airbnbs versus the hotel chains, on and on. So I think the key is, how do you make your business a great digital and algorithmic business? And we're trying to rebrand HEB, and we're making massive efforts to fast become a tech company, because we've got a lot of tech companies trying to fast become a retailer, and that is the race. And I think there's no company that's going to survive unless they put the pedal to the metal and become a tech company as fast as humanly possible and attract talent that's going to be able to do that. This is a war.
And by the way, the reason you think that is just the price and convenience beats traditional models. Why do you think they're going to, the Venmos and these others, are going to win?
Well, I do think that there are, despite my little rant on the risks of innovation, and you can throw me off the stage whenever.
No,
you're
I thought
ready.
It was good. We're gonna talk more. We're gonna talk more about this.
Yeah, I do think. I just want to be clear. I think there's massive benefits and opportunities for the tech innovation to make our businesses dramatically better. Like we talked about with the supply chain, the ability to improve our businesses. There are just unintended bad parts of that that we have to address.
But the reason you think an Airbnb will beat hotel, you're saying if you're a hotel business, got to move there faster. Just the price and convenience is just,
becomes dominant. One-on-one marketing, much better service of customers,
okay.
And speed and convenience is out there, and companies have to move a lot faster and be much more nimble and be able to become, have all of the great tech tools that we don't have now.
Brant, comment?
Yeah, I would just add, I mean, we share some of the same challenges that have already been mentioned. I think one of the challenges that we have that's maybe unique to us is that we've been around for 170 years, right? And so when people think of freight, talent thinks of freight railroads, they don't think of tech until they see the scale, size and scale of our operation. Mm-hmm. So we share some of the same challenges. The only add-on I would have is that we have found that, and it ties in my comments around the deployment side, is that talent not only wants to work in a digital environment and be able to develop technology, but they want to see the result of that product, right? So they want to work in a company that has a culture that is willing to deploy their work product and adopt those technologies.
Got it. That's interesting. Yeah, please.
Hi, Brad Cowan, Senior Global Finance and Economics Correspondent for The Street, and I must confess, I am an obsessed AGB shopper. I want to take it back to Rob's comment during his intro about pricing power. And I mean, you know, I see it in my daily life, just how much easier it is to find a cheap plane ticket due to all of the online services or, you know, everything. I mean, Amazon is like become my first call when I'm looking for something because it's cheaper a lot of times than what's in the store. So, I mean, I guess primarily for Craig, since you're in the retail space, but maybe Brant and Greg in the wholesale business, love to hear how this widespread adoption of the internet and distributed pricing information has affected your pricing power.
Yep. I think it's a really good question. I think there's no question that the amount of competition is going up. And therefore,
it's pretty simple, margins go down, right? So I think pricing and margins go down for a long time in the future. Unfortunately, in the retail space, the ability to fulfill groceries on a one-on-one basis is more expensive than through a store, if you just think about from a rail car to a warehouse to a store, much more efficient than an individual. So margins go down, costs go up. Pretty simple equation. I think Walmart is doing a great job becoming a much better e-commerce business. And you know, they're one of our main competitors, but I'm very proud of the work that they're doing to fast become a tech company. And as a public company, their financials are available to everybody to see. And that is an expensive proposition. So Walmart's net earnings as a percent of sales are now 70% lower than they were 5 years ago, right? And they've shaved $7 billion in dollar terms off their net income line. But they're doing a heck of a job. Their e-commerce business is up, I think it was
37%, continues to thrive. They continue to be a stronger omni-channel company. The Street is recognizing that. Their stock is going up. And I think that's a good example of a good company trying to reinvent themselves, but the margins going down, costs going up are easily seen through the lens of the Walmart income statement.
So we don't see that in our space in terms of technology influencing price. I mean, I think it goes back to my comments around the supply chain and the interchange points of information or physical assets. So if we can be technology can help us be safer, faster, more reliable, that enables us to provide more value in the supply chain to our customers. So we can give drivers that come in and out of our facilities a better experience, which means they get better cycle times. That makes them faster and more reliable. That's more valuable to the shippers that ship on our
railroad. So people out here may be wondering two things for you, and then Greg wants to comment. What percentage of your business is trade-related, and how are these trade tensions and issues affecting you? And then second, we've had an explosion of warehouses. And, you know, all these new models mean there's more warehouses. It must be affecting your logistics, your business. But let's start with trade.
Yeah, so the first part of your question is about 40% of all of our rail car loads and intermodal units are directly tied to trade.
Yeah.
And how it's impacting our business, I mean, I think to the degree there's uncertainty means that there's uncertainty in the markets and the supply chains. We can't really tie the specific, you know, ongoing conversations, real-time conversations right now to our business. There's a lot of noise, though, in our system right now around the extreme weather that we've had to deal with for the front part of the year, with, you know, frigid temperatures on the front part and then the widespread flooding that we've had on our network. So I would say uncertain at this point from the trade perspective.
Okay. And the proliferation of warehouses in the United States, first, is it accurate that there's been a proliferation of warehouses? It seems to us there is. And how's it affecting your job and the logistics, particularly the logistics part of your business?
Yeah, so it really fits our model very nicely. And okay. So on the intermodal side of things, trailers and containers again, we have long leveraged a strategy, what we call logistics parks. So that's where we have an industrial development, a rail center, a rail hub, surrounded by warehousing and distribution. What that does is lower the final mile costs in the supply chain. And so we're able to do the long haul, high density movements, lower the trucking costs to the distribution center, which improves the overall supply chain. So yes, there has been an explosion of warehousing and distribution. We like that, and we like it when it's around our rail network.
So back to the question, I guess I'd just add, and we're more on the industrial side as opposed to obviously the retail side. So we're part of the value chain as opposed to, you know, toward the end of the value being delivered. And I would just say on the price competition issue is quality of service, and I think that's what Brant was touching on. And, you know, if the answer is people, you know, all services being equal, they're going to go to the cheapest. But if they have one bad experience and it costs them a tremendous amount of money or a customer, it shows up. And so that quality of service issue in the industrial side is going to be very important. We have customers that are producers that don't want to be told we can't take your oil. And we've got refiners on the other end says we've got to have oil to keep our factories running. So I'd say quality of service is important. If I can jump into the retail from a personal perspective, though, I can also tell you it applies there, too, because – you know, and we've done, and no disrespect, we've, you know, experimented with HEB and a few others, and you go back to the one that gives you the best service. It's not necessarily the price. I mean, you want to get a good price, but you want to get good value, and value comes in quality of service. We've had the home delivery where they show up and they say, well, we had to substitute four items, okay, from what you ordered, and the answer is, quite candidly, I just seen you not provided them at all. And so, I mean, my wife and I have had this discussion, and we sit there and say, you know what, these are quicker, but these are better, or this is cheaper. And so I'd say quality of service is going to be a distinguishing characteristic ultimately. You know, you don't want to get the cheapest hotel room and find out the door doesn't lock and there's visitors in your room that you just do not have there. So, you know, it's you know, over time, those tend to level out. And if you have enough of a bad experience, you just don't go back. You don't care about that. And so we're back at HEB now. So
thank you. We're glad to have you back.
I'm curious to hear, one of the things we're observing is a higher concentration in industries. So there's a lot of consolidation going up and more of a winner-take-all type of attitude with this fight for technology and kind of who can go faster. What would you say it will take to actually swing the pendulum back so that smaller companies, you know, have a shot at it? Because even though you're talking about a lot of new entrants coming in because of the low cost of capital, I would almost argue it's the largest companies that seem to be getting stronger and pulling away from the rest of the crowd.
So let's talk about this, how this is unfolding in your industries. There's stories in every industry about how new entrants versus traditional competitors and how it's changing the balance of power. You might just talk about it. You want to start, Craig?
I think that's an excellent point. And you see it in many of the big companies are getting stronger, and I think the capital markets are sustaining that. And but there, you know, just there are fewer checks on kind of antitrust power, and it's just not appropriate for the modern era. And I think it does need to become more appropriate. And I do think we need to get back to investing in people and labor versus dividends and buybacks. And you know, last year, S&P invested 27% of their cash flow in CapEx and almost double that in dividends and buybacks. So, you know, I think there's a bunch of, like, structural things that I'm really glad there's a bunch of smart people here that can figure out how to address that and fix it, but we can certainly see the manifestations of it. The one thing that I would say in the retail space is different. It's not universally going all big. So I think retailers are getting to be bigger, and you're seeing the power of some of these big marketing and online companies. But you're also seeing the rise of lots of smaller suppliers. And so there's, you know, consumer packaged goods companies, Pepsi, Frito, you know, Coke, Bud, Procter. those companies have struggled growing their business as an industry, and where the real growth is actually in smaller companies focused on a unique niche of the market. So the one thing that this innovation has allowed is easier entrance for small companies to get started and to serve a small niche, like Chewy or much smaller. But we're seeing the ability for many small suppliers to get to market with a lower cost model quicker in a more efficient way. And so that's kind of the wonderful part. So I think it's kind of a bimodal experience that we're seeing.
And by the way, Craig, just to clarify, and they're doing it because they can rent the technology. In the old days, they would have had to develop it themselves. Today, they can just buy it.
They can rent the space. They can rent the app. Like you can be up and running in a couple of days. So that's a pretty wonderful part of this innovation. But it still doesn't address, like, how do you solve the big guys.
So what about industry consolidation or impact on industry concentration? I know in your industry, we'll go Greg first, then Brant. How's it affecting that, this technology trend?
So there's no question scale wins, and the efficiencies and I mean, just lowering cost. Again, if you're trying to deliver the same quality service and you can lower the cost, and we're seeing this in our industry. I tend to agree with Craig in one sense, and I'm about free market capitalist, but I believe there are limits. I think the pendulum can swing too far either direction. And even in our business, I go back to, Rockefeller and having to break up, standard. They'd gotten too big. And I think we're going to run a risk of some of this there. But for the time being, we're in this phase right now in our business. It's been disrupted. We've got, 150 companies trying to do what we do, okay? And we'll consolidate some of those. And at some point in time, there'll be a discussion in the future about, are we getting too big, okay? But I believe we're in the early part of that cycle. I think there's other industries that are in the advanced part, and I worry about, the moms and pops and the, the way, mother home and apple pie in the city.
Let me ask you one follow-up on that. So historically, antitrust policy in the United States has been focused on, is it good or bad for the consumer? If the answer is good for the consumer, it's tended to be allowed. Do you think it should be different criteria for antitrust policy? I know I'm asking you this on the spot.
I think they have to change the formulas they've been using, the HHI index. And in our business, it's the consumer is the major oil companies that we provide the service to. And ultimately, they've kind of stood back and said they can kind of police themselves. I just think in other industries, and I'm talking about industrial, I think we're in good shape.
Yeah.
I think ultimately we'll have a problem in the future. I think on the retail side, it's already got to where it's a little bit of an issue. And so I kind of agree with Craig and some of his voice. I think we've got to relook at it and say the rules we put in place 100 years ago need to be revisited.
Okay. Brant, what do you think?
So, I mean, I think there's two parts to that question for us. In the first being, in terms of the shipper consolidation or retailers, we don't really see that directly influencing our lines of business. Our paying customers are the motor carriers or the steamship lines, the contents inside the box are not necessarily our customers, but we know that Walmart's a big cargo owner inside the box. We know that Amazon's a big cargo owner inside the box. But then we also have the other side of our business, which is the traditional carload side of our business, and that's got thousands of customers. And actually 75% of those customers receive one carload per week.
Huh.
And so they're very small shippers. But where I think we do see some of the influence in our business is really on expectations. So to the extent that a large player can give a business-to-consumer experience that is new, different, and better, we're starting to see the business-to-consumer experience influence the business-to-business expectations. So if I can order a set of drumsticks for my youngest child from Amazon and have it delivered in 2 days and know where it's at and exactly when it's going to be at my house, that's a consumer experience that, as a shipper of freight, I start to expect. I start to expect the visibility and transparency in the supply chain that says, where's my container and when's it going to be where it's supposed to be? So we see those as opportunities to improve visibility in the supply chain, if that makes sense.
That's great. Jill.
Good morning. I wanted to come back to the question around automation, and I was curious, it would seem like ex ante, I wanted to hear a little bit about your process for thinking about some of the possible costs that could be associated with automation, and particularly tail costs. You can think about, for example, ransomware and the potential for that to cause problems in warehouses, just in terms of cyber incursions. I guess I'm wondering, ex ante, as a businesswoman, thinks around the costs of adopting some of these technologies, how we think around some of the risk management pieces and what can go wrong. And I think this is alluded to a little bit, but some more discussion I think would be welcome.
You want to start, Greg?
Yeah, I think that's an excellent point, and I think that cyber security risks have escalated to the top of every board room, and this the one of the top concerns of every business. And it's, we didn't talk about that as an innovative space, but that is, of course, probably the largest booming business out there is cybersecurity and how we're each going to protect the data assets, because sensors and data are now getting into every aspect, and having somebody take over an autonomous vehicle and steer your Tesla off the road, or drive your, manufacturing gone like Lucille Ball crazy, or, who knows what. There are a lot of opportunities to do real damage, and I think we probably all get hacked every day, multiple times a day, and we're constantly fighting attempts to hack into systems and get our data. So it is, it's just an ongoing war. I don't think there's a destination to this other than constantly trying to stay one step ahead.
How about you, Brant?
I mean, I would agree with what Craig just outlined. It's a constant battle. It's a challenge for us. I think that could, and that concern, it probably does feed into some of the pace of adoption, right, to make sure that we have the right information governance, the right cybersecurity, those things in place before we just widely deploy some sort of autonomous or automation capability in an operation the size of our scale.
Great.
I think they've covered it well. I'd say the only other thing it adds to our business is national security because of the issues of the lifeblood of the crude oil systems.
So we've got a few minutes left. Let me ask each of you to comment. What would you? I'm sorry. Oh, Augustine. Well, you should. I will defer to Augustine Carson.
Thank you very much, Rob. I was doing my exercise here. Being
I think it's great.
I want to ask a question to Craig. Obviously, all of them can answer, but I think it's more relevant to him. But first, a petition. Here we have a Texan and myself, who is Mexican. We're working in Basel, in Switzerland. We'd love to get some tortillas from you. If you could provide that service, it would be greatly appreciated.
Happily. Then, we're the largest exporter of tortillas to Mexico, so go figure.
Well, wow. If you manage to get them to Switzerland, it would be great. I've been working in central banking for 40 years or so. Central banks are quite involved in payment systems. And especially for retail and for all the innovation around retail, and indisputable and quite necessary complement to any change in retail technology has to be payments. And well, of course, from many, many years, decades, even more than centuries, we're used to cash. Cash has been reduced in use. It's not gone and probably will not be gone for a while. But what I would like to ask you is from your point of view as a retailer, what would you tell the industry, which is on the payment side? What would you like to have? What would you like to see? What we have now is appropriate or not. So I just was curious because I think this is an excellent opportunity to get your points of view.
Okay, thank you. I think that's an excellent point. And, major payments is a major source of innovation that's happening across. We talked about Venmo earlier, but just how people move money around, I think, is ripe for innovation. And who knows whether it'll be blockchain or other kinds of micropayment systems. As a retailer, one of the main struggles is we see a lot of innovation on payments, but we also, and forgive me for the bankers in the room, but I have a major beef with the bankers in the room. The cost of payments to retailers has gone up exponentially. So the cost has probably quadrupled in the last 10 years on the cost of payments because we've shifted from cash to credit And we've been trying to work debit hard, and we're all big fans of debit and ACH and other low-cost ways. But fundamentally, retailers are not allowed to negotiate with credit card processors and the credit companies. And all of those wonderful cashback rewards programs have absolutely quadrupled over the past decade. And the entirety of that cost is passed on to the retailer and then to the consumer, who neither of whom can negotiate that cost. That is a major problem where we've got no negotiating power, legally stopping negotiating power for us, and it's now one of our largest cost items. Wow. Is paying the credit card processing, which is more than the value of, you know, net earnings in many cases, to pay the processing of extra rewards credit card fees. That cannot continue. You have allowed me the soapbox.
All right, that's good. I'm glad you asked that question. In the last couple of minutes, is there a final comment, something you would have liked to, you'd like to leave this group with? We hope a number of the folks in this audience will go back, and this will motivate, they'll do more research on this. This will increase in their consciousness, and we'll achieve better understanding. If there's any closing comments each of you would make, just you want to leave the group with, or something you want to emphasize that they ought to think about as they leave this session.
Sure. For me, I mean, I think one of the things that I like to reinforce is that, you know, from my experience in our industry, there's always an awful lot of discussion around displacing the workforce. And I just want to reinforce, and I think I said it earlier, that we just don't see a path where there's a piece of technology that you buy off the shelf and you plug it in and you immediately displace an employee. That really happens over the pace of adoption of that technology. And it really kind of follows a natural, you know, human ingenuity in terms of employees that come into the workforce are more technically competent no matter what role they play, and they're more comfortable in that environment. And so I don't see that, you know, Armageddon, if you will, of automation.
The worker in their 40s that just isn't technically competent, but the business changed while they've been with you, I gather you offer them opportunities to retrain them.
Absolutely. We actually have a technical training center that we partner with Johnson County Community College in Kansas City. And if you think about our industry, I mean, the locomotive of when I started 24 years ago versus the locomotive of today is far more sophisticated today than when I started, but it really didn't displace anybody. We retrained the, you know, locomotive engineers, and they were, as new engineers came in, that was their locomotive. Engineers that were operating the former locomotive got trained through the course of their career, so they're increasingly more comfortable with that new technology. So I think it's more of a natural progression than it is a displacement.
This is part of your contract with people who join you.
Absolutely. We training, ongoing training.
The psychological contract.
Absolutely. That's right. That's right.
Okay. Great.
Can I build on top of that? I do think people is a really big topic, and obviously in the retail world, we're losing lots of jobs in the industry. But at HEB, we're growing jobs the same as what Brant talked about. We're about 116,000 partners, we call our employees. We've added about 40,000 jobs in the last decade here in Texas. And we sometimes compete against companies where we're not sure if they wanna have no people or lesser people, but we really believe the answer for us is to win with better people and to invest and have more inspiring experiences that great people running each store can take care of the employee base and lead an inspired group of people to have dramatically better experiences. So we are in a world where we believe the main thing we have to do is invest in people and better people and make people a differentiating factor in an increasingly tech no people world. And I think there's a lot of companies out there that are like that. However, many of us here live in Texas, and we all do worry about the macroeconomic picture and the future of education in our state. This is a state that's growing, but median household income is declining. It's projected to decline for the next 40 years. We have massive issues of what's going to happen with the jobs and the training of our children. We are the largest private funder of public education here. We're working on how to do CAST and STEM school training in the schools. But there needs to be, and there are many educators here that are a lot smarter than me. We believe a great answer for educational system is to have great leaders in the retail business, have a great leader running each store that can inspire people in that store. We believe the same thing in the schools, have a great leader who can run a great school and inspire teachers and students in that school, get the bureaucracy off their back, like get all of the complexity out and invest in people and put a lot more funding into inspiring teachers. And we think that is the future of our state. So that's something we worry a lot about.
Great.
So I'd echo both their comments. I would just add two other aspects to it. One, I think we've gone through a phase where everybody was encouraged, everybody needs a college education. I think in today's world, I would probably say that's not the case. And in fact, I would say there's some skills training out there that could be done. And I think, trying to make people accept that, or at least have it as an acceptable answer, as opposed to say, if I don't go to college, I'm a failure, that's not the case. The other side of it is, I think it's incumbent upon from an industrial standpoint, on the companies themselves to integrate themselves into the local communities and help train that. And in many cases, we're having to reach out to develop that workforce and say, look, these are the skills we need. We'll work with the local VOTEX and the colleges, or even, bring people in their 40s and say, we'll train you to do this. We'd like to have that psychological contract that says, if we train you, you won't go to work for our competitors. But effectively, we have to do that because the skill sets that we need today don't match what's coming out of the colleges today.
And that's a great setup for some of the discussions we're going to have as the day goes on. Thank you to all three of you. And I think we're going to take a 15-minute break, so thank you very much.
Slowed down my traveling a little bit. I've been busy the first part of this year.